So today, you may be a guest, and this is an unusual Sunday because I'm doing a State of the Church, and I do it annually a lot of times, and I want you to get a breath and be ready, because in a minute, you're going to have your mouth on a fire hose. So I've got a lot to deliver in these next minutes that I have, and then we'll use the team and then see you back in a moment. So my outline is basically for today, this message is past, present, and future, and I start with this scripture from Philippians 1:6 that says it very well. I love the language. I am certain. Don't you like that word certainty? How many know there's still certainty in these days of uncertainty? I am certain. That sounds like definite, made up in mind. I am certain, and I put parenthetically, real time, all the time, I am certain that God, who began the work, as in the past, the good work within you, where within you, will continue it to the present, his work, until it is finally finished, and that's the future, on the day when Christ Jesus returns. So I seldom miss an opportunity to say that one of the biggest challenges we have nowadays, one of the biggest disciplines is to get God's word in us. His word gives us loving boundaries, I talked about in the last series, to live within in order to experience the greatest freedom that we can know in this life. We believe in freedom under God's sovereign rule. We sing so much about his sovereignty. And last week I talked about Jesus. He's full of grace and truth, and his grace is compelled and propelled by his great love for us. We choose to surrender, and I want you to catch this. We choose to surrender. We go, as we say, palms up under his love-driven authority. Authority without love is deadly, but his love-driven authority. And listen to this, we must never stop. We talk about here all the time about beginning a relationship with Jesus. We say yes to Jesus. So I wrote, we must never stop saying yes to our yes to Jesus. In other words, we say yes. Yes, I believe what you did. You died for me. I accept. I confess. I repent. I turn to you. But I'm going to live in that yes. How many of you know that that's what we need to do? We need to live in that eternal yes. We keep leaning into yes, in other words, no matter what the seasons. And like Jesus, we need to live in this crazy culture full of grace and truth. No compromise on either. And while our topsy-turvy culture dangerously careens, changes, and free falls morally, God's truth is standing undaunted, firm, unshakable. And I want to tell you, we are determined to align with God and his word. We are going to stand firmly on God's side with God's worldview, and we will never cave, and we will not even compromise. No compromise. I was thinking just briefly, over the weekend, just turned briefly on the Olympics opening ceremony, a portion of it. I just turned it on. I thought, talk about decadence. And I'm not talking about the games, you know, figure it out. I mean, shocking, shocking. So at age 68, which I am, at 68, I'm still, and I'm not bragging, I'm just laying it out who I am. I'm still a passionate vision caster and a creative dreamer of what can be. I scratched out could, it's really what can be. With a can-do attitude, I want always to keep on getting better. I need to, I must. As we keep moving forward as a church together, I like to say it's okay to aim for perfection. We know we never will be as humans, but let's just settle for excellence instead. Is that okay? I like to say something like this, and staff knows it. I'm often pleased. We talk about it. We debrief. I love it. But I'm never satisfied because I've always believed something can be better. There's more to come. So, always more to come, and here's why. Because another key verse is found in Hebrews 13:8 that says, Jesus Christ is the same. Can you help me? Yesterday and I think that covers all the seasons and all the tenses, don't you? Past, present, future. So that's our hope. I love music of all kinds. I like the new stuff, the old stuff, the hymns of the church. And one of my favorite is, Oh God, our help in ages past. And the lyrics go like this. Oh God, our help in ages past, our hope for years to come. And that's what I'm full of today, hope. Be thou our guard while life shall last. But that's not the end of it. And our eternal home. Under the shadow of thy throne, that's under his sovereignty, under his control, love-driven authority, thy saints, that's Jesus' lovers, have dwelt secure. Sufficient is, listen to this. Sufficient is thine arm alone, and our defense is sure. Don't look to man Man isn't sufficient. Sufficient is thine arm alone, O God. We worship you and no other. And so we go to the past. Are you ready? Set, go. All right, get your mouth on that fire hose. And don't tell me I talk too fast, because it's going to come at you. Just if you miss something, go back and watch it or listen to it again. Psalm 13, 5 and 6. Thinking about the past, reflecting, and I've been doing a lot of that. But I have trusted in your faithful love. Can anybody agree with out there? I have trusted in your faithful love. My heart will keep rejoicing in your deliverance. I will sing to the Lord because he has treated me generously. Has the Lord been generous with anybody in this room? And just don't think material things. Just think about his generous love where he has extravagantly poured out on you and your family, and he's not done. My father was a full-time Nazarene pastor for 43 years. Some of you know it, but we have so many new people. I want to give everybody the picture here, a little history. He went to heaven in 2010. My two brothers are now retired, but they served as full-time Nazarene pastors for 45 and 49 consecutive years, respectively. And I'm so thankful for them. I'm so proud of them because they left huge tracks for me to follow as the youngest in the family. Being a preacher's kid, and we've got some preachers, other preachers' kids in here today, and I don't know how you feel about it, but this is my reflection. Looking back, it best prepared me to be a pastor, being a preacher's kid. I'm thankful. I was taught a lot of things, but I did more catching than being taught, probably. I caught lots of common sense, an intuitive sense of just knowing, and a heart for genuine, compassionate leadership. And that's interesting because I grew up in the middle of the church, the good, the bad, and the ugly. I mean, I saw the underbelly of the church. And if you can get through that, you're not rocked by all the wind and waves that blow in later times. But I'm forever grateful for my heritage. I don't lord that over anybody. I'm grateful. I'm blessed. When it comes to blessings, we were born with a silver spoon in our mouth spiritually, and I'm thankful for it. And I want to pass that legacy on. Our little family came to serve Wooster Church of the Nazarene in May of 1995. After serving in several associate roles, and we started in Cincinnati, Ohio, and then in Indianapolis and Coshocton, full-time in 1979. And I can honestly say in Dixie Greer, we loved every place we were. We loved all the people every place we were, but we're not there, we're here. And I want to tell you, we're all here. We're all here. Our children, I had to use my fingers for this, but Nate, Caleb, and Hillary, they were 11, 9, and 7. Some were going to change ages that year, but that's where they were when we came, as I figured. If not, Dixie will correct me when we get home. Wooster has proven to be a wonderful place to raise our kids and to help them fall in love with Jesus and his church, and I get emotional about it because I'm overwhelmed. Our kids and grands are still the best thing we have going for us, and we love it here. And I love it that our grandkids are being raised in the Wooster Naz family among some of the best people on the planet. I love it. I see a loving on my kids and my grandkids, and it means the world for me. And I want to tell you, I want the same for you and yours because these are the best of the best. So grateful. Wooster Naz story I penned, I'm always aware of this. We had a church. We didn't come and start this church or plant this church. We had a church to come to and serve because of the faithfulness of all the pastors and people before us. And I know who you are, and I'll never forget you. We had shoulders to stand on, so to speak, and a foundation to build on. And this morning, we had a former PK's daughter Robin, and her family was a West Haver family. And so I remember and honor and salute them today. Wherever they may be, some of them, many of them are in heaven. But hear me also, this has been a journey, a roller coaster in some ways, mostly up, but times. And I also want to acknowledge and extend my sincere thanks to former associates, all of them, staff and lay leaders who served Wooster Naz faithfully through various seasons of growth and change and transition. We went through a lot together. Some no longer serve here or maybe attend here, and some are even in heaven, but they made significant contributions along the way. I would never have thrived without them. I don't believe in surviving. Did you catch me? I like to invent words because it confuses my computer. I would never have thrived this journey alone, and I'm so grateful for all of you, whenever that would have been. We wouldn't be where we are today without you. As I recall, there were over 160 people in attendance our first Sunday in May of 1995, and it was a Mother's Day. And I said, I'll say again, there was a solid core of wonderful, God-loving people here when we live, right? But there was a sense for us of discouragement, of low morale, and low expectations, but there was still hope because their hope was in God and not man. And I just wonder, pause a moment, were there any of you here back in 1995 when we came? Come on, raise your hand, Art. And some of you whose hands are raised, I still can see you walking up the Parsons driveway, that crazy angle drive, giving us a food pounding soon after we moved in. I don't remember if you remember that, Dixie, but I do, and it meant the world to us. So we came to Wooster Naz with simple priorities of loving God and loving people. Does that sound familiar? It should, because these two things are still in our vision, vital pieces of our vision frame and reflecting. Here are some significant things that I can remember that created momentum and trajectory in those early days. I would say something like this from the very start. I never have said we're the best of anything, and you know that, but I said there should be no friendlier gathering of Jesus Church than Wooster Naz. And the people embrace that. And then we begin this journey. We begin to learn about worship and experience worship together. And that has its ups and downs. I mean, we've made some changes. Before one Sunday, if some of you know what the old church looked like and the pews were all over the place, without asking for permission, my family, Dixie and all the family, we came in and we changed all the pews around. And when people came in, we unbolted them and all the ones on the side were facing in. Oh my lands, you would have think something major happened. But little did they know that was just the start. But nobody left over that one, but this was a stretch. One of our first Christmases, because we started doing Christmas musicals with orchestra and all that, and we had wonderful times. But this was a keynote time, and I can still see Pastor Tom Myers coming in from off stage, and we did Michael Bolton's version of Joy to the World. He had a leather jacket on and jeans and a scarf around his neck. Oh my, things went from good to not so good at that point. And then I have the band here because I want them to do a song that I think about because we transitioned the style of worship and this song created no small stir. How many of you ever heard, Lord, I lift your name on high? You know, it kind of had that look, Lord, I lift your name on high, Lord, I love to sing your praises. And we decided it'd be really fun to syncopate it one day. And we did. And it was loved and hated. Because we gave a little twist, a little rhythmic. And so I want you to sing this, and then we're going to come back with another version at the end. But this was a change point. There was no looking back from what we did one Sunday morning. Were any of you there when we sang it this way for the first time? I'll bet you were. Here we go. Sing it out. Here we go. Let's sing.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises.
I'm so glad
you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven.
Does anybody remember that? Oh, my land. Some people even started moving and swaying in church a little bit, and that was really questionable. Another thing that happened, I think, our first Easter, and is that we launched Easter Ministry, doing a major production, if you call it, but we call it ministry. And we did it for 8 consecutive seasons. And that first year, I don't know, we probably did it a couple times, never dreaming that on the 8th season, we'd be filling that worship center that sat uncomfortably 400, 14 times the last time we did it. And the fruit of that over the years has been just remarkable. Anybody in the room or online, I can't see you, but you know who you are. If you had anything to do with Easter Ministry of those 8 seasons, would you raise your hand high and wave it at me? Yeah, probably. I mean, really, at least 3/4 of our whole church was involved in that. It was truly remarkable and brought us together. We could accomplish something that we couldn't do on our own. And then another thing, shortly after we arrived here in Worcester, our family, Dixie and I, started hosting people in our the Nazarene Parsonage. Does anybody remember that was by the YMCA on Woodland Avenue? And since then, I promise you, I am not pastorally exaggerating. We have hosted thousands of people on our property and in our homes, and it all started in that humble beginnings. We didn't wait till we got another room. We did it at the, we'd have 100 people in the yard at the parsonage, parking at the YMCA. It was wild and crazy, but it was so much fun. And I want to promise you, there's more of that to come. By the way, I'm trying to dispel rumors today and give you the scoop, and you can go back. It's documented. You can review it. But if you haven't heard, Dixie and I recently sold our home to our son, Nate and Kayla. And they've moved in, and they're settled. They own it. We're homeless now. Ours is not a happy story. Strong, one of my grandsons, let's go home. He goes, it's not your home, Grandpa, it's ours. We're living in the basement where Dixie's parents used to be all those years, and they throw scraps down to us now. But sometimes we throw scraps up. But we're going to build a home. We have started now. The foundation's up. I should have showed you a picture in the same allotment. It's the first lot on the north corner to the right when you turn in. Dixie's always had her eye and heart on that lot for a future home. And the new address is 2481 Lincoln Way Farms Road. At least we don't have to re-memorize a street address. That's a good thing. It'll be white and black ranch farmhouse style with wide open floor plan and a walkout basement. And there'll be plenty of room upstairs and downstairs so we can continue to practice hospitality there. And you will be invited. I guarantee it. We guarantee it. And I'm speaking for us because some of you think, I can't believe what you make Dixie do. I don't make Dixie do anything, especially these days. The older she gets, the more spunky she's getting, let me tell you. Mine is not a happy story. Still reflecting from the start, there was a great deal of spirit-led spontaneity in our worship, just in what we did, along with a sense of forward movement and purpose and momentum just begin to build. I mean, it wasn't so much, I'm not a numbers guy, never have been, but you could just feel it and you could see it. And we weren't afraid to take bold but calculated risks. I'm not sure we took many calculated risks back then. We took a lot of risk. I'm doing more calculated risk now. I'm not afraid of risk, but I do calculate a bit. The prayer and altars were so significant. Our altar space was intentionally redesigned and began to be constantly used. I'm so thankful for that. And I love this too. I love it having the teens in here, the middle school too. I love it. The teens and young adults, and I want you to know this is true, were front and center of all of it. I mean, they led the way in worship. They helped us. They were on the platform. I mean, they were all in, and they filled the front section, and they lifted the whole atmosphere, just like all of you still do. And I'm so thankful for that. And we want to build on this moving into the future. And then we moved, still reflecting, we moved into our present location here at 3100 Oak Hill, 20 acres about, and this building, and it wasn't quite finished, 70,000, but we moved into 70,000 square feet, and that was in October 2006. And did any of you march with us up the mile from the old campus to the new? And I still pulled, nobody over here. No, you're too young to remember that. Yeah. We had that walk, and that was just a really neat thing. Some road, and we had plowed the ground Grandpa had plowed it with his John Deere, I believe, in such a meaningful time. Then we occupied it, and then that was significant. And then a real time after some tough years where we really struggled, we entered something we called Church Unique, and that was a 15-month season of revisioning. That was in 14 and 15, and a team of 15 that consisted of some staff members, some church board members, and some lay leaders, and together we prayerfully and carefully created or crafted our present forward thinking all season vision frame. And I think it's up here on the screen, or will be. And it's really interesting because it was very forward thinking, and we're leaning into that and we're living into that even now. When you get that vision frame slide, would you please put that up for me, if you will? So thankful for that. And then we recently completed a building space back here, and I think there's about 8,000 square feet that we completed, and we have gotten so many compliments on that. I think all of you have been back there. I mean, that place is used like crazy, and everybody that sees it raves on it. We're so thankful. We filled up. We've got kids galore back there even now as I speak. And then I remind you that unfinished portion, but enclosed, we have another 15,000 square feet. It's like a footprint underneath of what's above it, the gym and all. And by God's grace, we believe he's going to enable us to finish that and to utilize that for his glory. So thankful for that. So there we are in the vision frame, and we're still, that's still so applicable. The vision frame is what we're about, our mission, value, strategy, measures. What are we doing? We're loving God, loving people, living transformed. Why are we doing that? Because we believe in truth and prayer and worship and kindness and generosity, and those are building blocks. And our strategy is we've got to continue to gather, link, and thrive no matter what our culture does. We've got to keep doing that, and we can measure success because we can check those boxes. We're gathering, we're growing, we're giving, we're going out, in other words, and we are genuine, being transformed by God's grace. And then thank you. And then another slide. And like I said, I'm not a numbers guy, but when I went back, I was amazed. I have in my notes that back in 94, 95, for that average, and our church year is from June 1 to May 31 of the next year. The first year when we got there, they had averaged 217. And financially, we had raised less than $250,000 a year. Now, this last year that we just completed at the end of May, we averaged 1,158 and nearly 400 online. And look at this, by God's grace, provided over $2,800,000. To God be the glory, great things he has done and wants to continue. Isn't that amazing? And our it hasn't been like a meteor. It's just been pretty much just a growth cycle through the years. And I was reminded of the scripture in Lamentations 3:22 and 3. The faithful love of the Lord never ends. Is anybody glad about that? Do you believe that? Do you receive that? His mercies never cease. Great is his faithfulness. His mercies begin afresh each morning. I'm so glad about that. No matter what the past has been, it's saying, it's a redo, it's a makeover. Every morning he says, this is the day that I've made. I want you to rejoice and be glad, and I want you to represent me and bring glory to your name. What an encouragement that is. No wonder we're hope-filled today. The past, there's far more, but we are in the present. And you know, it's interesting because I hear business people and all that sometimes when they get into a slump or something, they're like, what went wrong? What went wrong? What went wrong? And I think that's good. We need to evaluate that. But even when playing sports, we'd review the films and they'd run the bad plays right over. I wanted them to run the good plays over and over. You know what I'm saying? Because a lot of times, let's take in our spiritual life. If we're struggling compared to where we were, it's good not to say, what am I doing wrong? Go back here and go, what did I do right? And we go back, as it says in Revelation, do the former things, the first things again. That's how to analyze and get back on track. So I think about that in the present. So I love this present verse, and I've used this lately, sometimes preached about it, maybe, I don't know at what point, but recently, Philippians 2:13, that said, for God is, and I love that, that's present tense active, for God is working where? In you and me, giving you the desire and the power to do what pleases him. Aren't you glad about that? It's not our good works. It's not our effort. He's working in us because we're in him. We have a relationship with him. We're going palms up and surrendering to him. He'll give us the power to do us and the desire to do what he's called us to do. From my perspective, we are presently experiencing, enjoying our best days ever. And I say that because we've had some great ones and some good seasons for sure. And this has been true, think about it, what we've gone through, is through some of the most unlikely times and difficult seasons of life. And I got to tell you, it's not like this a lot of places. So many pastors and churches are really struggling. They've got barely one nostril above the waterline many times. And we are so thankful. It's not our cleverness. It's not about us. It's about who God is. So the present brings some significant changes. And I want to talk to some of these quickly and introduce you to some people via pictures. But I'm not at all discouraged about this. You know, I'm not at all discouraged. I think it's exciting. But I'm not pushing anybody away. I'm so thankful for the people that have served and are serving. But God is building a team. And I just got to tell you, for example, the Lord's faithfulness. After Randy and I had served as our buildings and grounds person for all these years, we didn't know what in the world we were going to do when he reached 70 and he told me he was going to be retiring. But the Lord provided a John Herman. And John Herman is building on the foundation that Randy laid and just taking it forward. So that just was saying like, yay, God, and that just said sick him, because we believe God's going to provide for us in every need. Don't we? We believe he is. Hey, teens, I want you to get excited about this stuff. I need some encouragement here today, okay? This is the second half of giving it all I got. So some staff changes, and next week we're going to remember that, but if you don't know, Pastor Jordan, raise your hand and wave at me. She is leaving officially her position as youth pastor. Next Sunday will be your last, correct? And we'll honor her that day, and we have some things planned we're going to do. But Jordan, thank you. You've been here 3 years, and I can't tell you how much you're on my favorites list and how much I love you and care for you. And we're going to miss you, but I've gleaned some things from your ministry that I'll address in a little bit that I think will have a long-lasting. And what you've poured into the life of teens, means the world to us. So we love you, and we know that you leaving doesn't mean you don't love us, right? We love you. We love you. And then in November, Deb is going to be hiring, and she's so old I can't even tabulate her age on my fingers. So, but she's going to be retiring. But the good news is she's going to be giving us 10 hours, and she's going to cherry pick and do some things she loves to do without. We've been peeling things off of her plate because she's had way more than she should have ever had on her plate. But she's going to give us 10 hours, and she'll be still consulting, and we're so thankful for her and Dave and what they do, for sure. And then Ruth, my administrator in the front office, I don't think Ruth's here. She ducked out after embarrassed her first service. But she's going to be finishing up after, I think, maybe 7 or 8 years, but she's going to be finishing up in December at least, and she's done a great job, has responsibilities of family with business that she needs to attend to, and we're thankful for her and believe that's good. And here's another thing. Don't misquote me on this. Don't misquote me. Hear me clearly. We got to start thinking about Pastor Cindy, because she just turned 68 her last birthday, and I got to tell you, she's doing her best work ever. Do you know what a gem she has been and is teaching our kids about Jesus? Some of you on the front row, you were impacted by her ministry, and some of my grands have been impacted by that. And I say that, say this, she's planning on going to 2026, and she plans on retiring when she's 70, and I wouldn't be surprised if she still volunteers, but she wants to give her attention to family and all. But would you help me pray into that position? Because great children's pastors like her don't grow on, you know, they just don't fall out of the sky. So we really need God to provide, because we want to create that continual, motion and all that. So please join me on that. So don't go out of here and go, hey, Cindy, I hear you're retiring right away. No, in 2026, okay, 2026. So that gives us a couple of years to fill that slot. Okay, so some new hires in light of this. Now, some of us get like, I can't believe we're paying all these staff people. We have budgeted, we have planned. I've said for years we're going to add part-timers with full-timers. We're going to mingle, and we can't do it without tons of volunteers. We've budgeted for it. Some of these things we're combining and we're changing. We're using money, pushing it from here to there. But I want to introduce to you by pictures on the screen. We got another gem, and her name is Taylor Abel. She's grown up here under another name, but she's married. And she's going to step into the connections coordinator. She's here now. She's got a lot on the learning curve. And she's also going to step into Ruth's position and administrate. There'll be some changes about how we delegate those jobs. But she's in that. And I'm so thankful for her. She's a good one, let me tell you. And then another thing, we've done media. We've done different combinations of our media, creative media. But we felt like we need to get somebody in-house after we'd hired a company, Mike's company, to do that. And so Shane Eder, and I don't know if he's in the church, he might be in the booth, but didn't he do a great job of putting that children's video together? Did you see that at the end about the prayer gathering? Phenomenal. But Shane has been trained for this, is that he loves the Lord, and he's got a sister serving as missionary in France now, but he's our creative media specialist, and I'm thankful. So reach out to him and be warm to him, introduce yourself, and get some of these people over to your homes, those are people that do that. Alicia Emma, she's another one that maybe you haven't seen. Next screen, she is a physical therapist, among other things. There she is, a little thing with lots of energy, and her family's been here for a long time. She has to work every Sunday, but she's going to take Deb's part-time kitchen responsibilities, and she's already in that role, just kind of being mentored in it, and she's going to be so excited. She's doing a great job already. Kathy Mullen, are you here in this service? Kathy, wave your hand. Great church men and women there in that family. She's serving, I think we call it a ministry liaison, but we really short on administrators and all that. She's really helping administrators, particularly outlinks and beyond, a very part-time position. But Kathy, we're so thankful to have you on the team. She's been in that role. So thankful for you. And then then on the right, you might recommend, Tom Barker's older than dirt. He was here before we got here. One of the musicals before I came here that they did, he passed out and fell into the poinsettias. Does anybody remember that? We had it on video. But our campus crew has expanded with all of the area, and he's filling. We've needed a part-time on the weekends and a fill-in for vacation, and he's doing that, doing a great job, so we're thankful. Welcome to the team. If I've forgotten anybody, I'll mention it later. I sure haven't meant to. So would you think about how many people does it take to make this happen every Sunday morning? Ruth looked online and said they came up with about 447 registered volunteers, and that's good of our crowd because we may have averaged, you know, around 1,200, but we have so many more people that call us their church home, and they come in shifts, as you know. But we lost count, way over, it takes over 100 people to make this work every Sunday morning. Easily, and we want to build on that. I'm so excited, too, in the present about Pray Now and the influence there. My family used to say things like this. My parents, a church family that prays together, stays together, and we're finding that to be true. We have Pray Now Thursdays. We have one coming up, obviously, on the 1st. We have prayer pods or pop-up, Pray Now pods. We have Pray Now pop-ups where they go to destinations and pray together, schools, whatever. Pray Now moments happen. We've had them today. They happen daily. They happen on Sundays, and we're glad. We're also continuing prayer and wholeness ministry. That's nothing new for us. We're thankful. Judy Fitzpatrick's at the point there, and doing great work with her team. So thankful for you just continuing what the foundation that's been laid. And that's just, God just does amazing things in concentrated prayer times to bring healing and wholeness, and we're glad for that. Alpha, we're getting ready for our third round. We've had two successful classes. That's going to be embedded in what we do, and that's just simply, that's appealing, especially to the unchurched and people to know, but there's been a lot of people going through it that want to be equipped for that, and it's just a safe atmosphere where people come and with their questions and be led towards the Lord, and we're thankful for that, and we're going to continue that. And then I'm thinking about other things like Women of Worth and Mothers on a Mission and Bible Study Fellowship and Women's Bible Study and Women's Discipleship, Release Time Education, The Rock and LifeWise and O-Huddle, where good people embed in school system to mentor, men's gatherings and men's Bible studies that are organic, men meeting in their homes, and I love it. Our military ministry is still thriving. We continue to connect and serve men and women in the military, and we continue to honor those veterans who have served and remember those who have sacrificed. We love that. Embrace Grace, we continue to move that forward. Me and the ministry to singles with unplanned pregnancies and to touch their lives with God's love. And Wooster Athletics, and we have basketball and volleyball and softball, and we even have 3 pickleball courts out back. Because you need to drive around the back on portable nets, right? So they painted this, and they added an extra pickleball court, or somebody did, and we're thankful for that. Tyler's at the point. You probably did the painting, and thank you. We have all those pet sports for people to, and far, far more. Those are just some things I'm thinking about presently. And when I think about all those things and more, I think about John 12:28, one of my life verses, Father, bring glory to your name. In everything we do, we want to point to you and praise you, from whom all blessings flow. So grateful, so thankful for the Lord. How about the future? Jeremiah 29:11, it's really well-worn and familiar, but I'll read a couple verses. For I know the plans I have for you. This is the Lord God speaking. They are plans for your good and not for disaster, to give you a hope in the future. Does anybody think that verse applies in 2024 and beyond? I do. I know it does. God's not done. He's sovereign. I know what the world's like, but God has plans for us. Who call ourselves Wooster Naz. In those days, in other words, I put parenthetically, these days, when you pray, I will. When you pray, I will listen, he says. If you look for me with all your heart, wholeheartedly, palms up, you will find me. I will be found by you, says the Lord. That's good news. There's hope. Don't buy into the Eeyorism of this world. There's hope because of him. My parents used to say, I can still hear them saying it, when we would go to visit homes for dinner, they'd always pray at the end, and they'd always say, the future is as bright as the promises of God. And I believe it more than ever now. They live, my parents did, in front of me with the optimism of hope. And I'm passionately optimistic about the future because of that example and because of God's unchanging word. So moving forward, let's make sure we keep wearing the altars out. Let's keep using them. Let's keep, because I'm going to say that the Holy Spirit shows up and he can do more in an instant in somebody's life, whether they plan that or not. We don't know all the things that led up to a God moment in a service worship together. You know what I'm saying? Where God can touch their hearts and they can respond. I'm going to tell you, I've heard testimonies recently of new life of people that have, I had a glowing testimony yesterday when Nate did a wonderful memorial of somebody who came to found Jesus, who was sharp. They came to find Jesus, that I knew about him, but I didn't know him. And what a drastic change in their life. Celebrate recovery. I have long held in my heart since the 90s. I went out to Saddleback. Dixie and I went. We took staff. I was there for multiple times. And I don't care how much criticism he gets. There are so many really good things that have happened in and through that ministry of Rick Warren. And I was there hearing his heart. And the original founder talked about Celebrate Recovery. And light went on. And we made a couple feeble, futile attempts to get it started. But we didn't have the leadership team in place. And it didn't last. But we do now. Rhonda Greer came to me. She's the chaplain at the Jail County Jail. And she's serving that role part-time. And then she joined a team, and Kim Friend has stepped up to the point to provide leadership. We've got a great team assembled, and we're going to open a recovery ministry come after the first of the year. Aren't you excited about that? But we're doing due diligence, and we're doing it right. And that's going to give you an opportunity. Some of you that know that have God's healed you from brokenness, we're going to need facilitators and leaders for groups and all that, so you'll be informed along the way. But thank you for leadership. The prep is so important. We can't just start things, and we're doing it well. And you know, we have not four seasons around here, but how many seasons do we have? And the blessing season, we think it's too short, so we're going to extend it this year. And we're going to start the blessing season on November 3rd, 2024, and we're beginning with the Samaritan's Purse Emphasis Operates Christmas Child Boxes. You supplied those and bring them in. And by the way, the deadline's here, so bring those in, but we're going to collect more, and we're going to bless people in wonderful ways. So I'm thankful for that. And then I'm just hitting a lot of topics here. The fire hose is coming even more. We have our grow track as well. I'll read at the end. And there's a lot more in that some of you already think with the Bible studies I mentioned, but I'll just fly over them. Some of the things that are and will be. We have Wooster Naz Basics. We have Alpha. We have Spiritual Gifts class that we're working on that's going to be coming our way. We have Celebration Recovery. There's discipleship in that. We have Senior Adult class of discipleship. There's discipleship in that. Naz groups, Bible study fellowship, men and women Bible studies. We're developing of My Freedom course, a standalone classes we do, and Today's Disciple, other things like that. Another thing that's big, and I have an example here. I think they brought me one, but we're doing these invite cards, and we're going to change them throughout. But that's a key word. I've read from multiple places recently that you know, over 90% will respond to something and go with you if you invite them. Not, hey, go there, but come with me. So we're going to have these cards that aren't dated. They may be for a special event, but you can take and you can hand to somebody. They can put it on the refrigerator and say, man, we'd love to have you. You know what? They just might show up. And we're the difference makers just through our simple invitation. So there's a handful. You can take a handful of them. They're on at the information center. Please take those. Let's keep that word before us. Invite. And then I'm skimming over some things like Loved Already. And we have a strategy team working to support foster care families. We've had families like that, and they labor alone so many times. And so we're taking steps to provide better support there. The NAS groups, we've had those. My thanks to leadership, Deb and others before that. Ben and Tracy have been leading it over the last year. Taylor Abel is stepping in that responsibility as a point person. It's in transition now, but we need more people to lead who have been trained, to step in to be facilitators. We've got to stay connected. It looks way different than when we started, and it can work with your schedule in life, but we think it's important. Another thing I'll say too is we transition and think about the future. We have something we call Planning Center, and we have information, and we have connect areas. We do everything we can to collect information. And you know what? Here's the problem. I can't tell you how many times I check the Planning Center looking for names as a reminder through the week. And you know what I find? We have names and faces, but the people I'm looking for. And I really have trouble finding the picture of macho guys out there. So what we're going to do, we're going to go on Facebook. We're going to drag the worst picture of you, one from the post office, and we're going to put that in your slot in Planning Center so we can know how. But could you help us there? We're going to have a system where we continually have ways to gain information and pictures. It's not to loan it out or to give it out to show it to others so they can bombard you with text and sales pitches, but for our information in-house, so you can help us there. We're going to continue to support the Pregnancy Care Center. We believe in their mission. We intend on providing and increasing our support there in this God-honoring ministry. Recently, we provided through Outlink some supplies for the store that they run into. There's going to be more of that. Serve teams, if you could say, this is my church, I heard glowing reports about that this week, then I would ask you, where's your serve? Where's your serve? We can't just come and go and come and go and come and go. That's good for a while. It's recovery. We've had church abuse. We've been overused and taxed. We need to recover, but then we need to find a place to serve. So I ask you again with love, where's your serve? If you say this is my, it's time for you to step up and step into the stream. We have something else developing, and I'll call it Special Needs Buddy System. And I got this idea from the Night to Shine. The last time I've gone, the last 2 years, just to greet our people, we have a number of people embedded in that ministry. It's held at Grace, and I like to call it the Church Up North. It's embedded there and held there. It's a joke in our house here. It's okay. But I was so touched by all the buddies that were there. I mean, they had lots of special need people there, people with special needs, but they had a great buddy system. I don't think there was extensive training, but there was some. So we're going to provide, Julie Donatini has agreed, she's going to provide professional training. That's her expertise, and coming up in August. And I just want to encourage you, if you have a heart for that kind of ministry, we're going to have a team. We've had people faithfully doing it week after week after week, and we have to broaden. Come on, we do teams around here because you wear people out. Our worship team, we have a team. They have on Sundays, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We have teams that do that, and we're going to build this team. So please, if you have a heart for that, it's spending time and being a buddy so that the family can refresh and be in worship. How many of you think that's a great idea? We're going to provide for that. So we want to see it come to that training, even if you're not locked in. That'll teach you more about it. Our membership process we keep before you again is this. We require that people go through our basics class. We have the best of the best teaching it. Pastor Andrew, Pastor Sheldon, Pastor Nate team up on that. That's the best of the best when they all have their feet on the campus. They do a great job. If you haven't been through that class, you ought to. If you've been here a long time, if you're new, take it. You'll find out about whether or not you want to be a part of us. But that's our step. And then we require baptism, that you've been or you'll be baptized. And then we say you got to have a serve. You're not saved to sit. You're saved to serve. So everyone who considers calling this Wooster Naz their church home, I encourage you to take these steps. Naz worship, we're engaged in that today. The world is demeaning that, but we got to keep gathering and linking and thriving. It's life-giving. God shows up, and I'm thankful for online. We do that well, but oh my, there's nothing like being together, and I love it. We never know what God's going to do. And then I would just take a moment to address, of course, outlinks, and I may have overlooked that, but outlinks is global. It's global, all things missions, global and local. It's our outlinks box. We remind everybody, we do it. Dixie and I bring multiple ones because a lot of you forget yours, so we're trying to cover you. But if we all do that, that's money we would never receive, and that's for others. We're teaching our kids and our grands to hit the box saying, Mommy, Daddy, and we're teaching them to deny themselves. No pop. This goes for others, and we're not going to. We have a world-class missions emphasis in the Nazarene Missions International in the Church of Nazarene and Compassionate Ministry that's local for disasters. So thankful. We're going to keep supporting those things. Thrive Youth Ministry. I'm so thankful for all the people that have served there, and I have a youth minister's heart. I did that for 16 years. We did it together as a family, couple of family. We loved it. It's still in our heart. We love teens as much as we always have, and I'm so thankful for that. And we are getting ready for some massive changes there, and more is going to come out. We have had input from our youth pastors, from our youth ministry team, and we take all that in consideration. But there's some things that we as a pastoral staff have to decide because this is going to affect the delicate balance of our church. But when it comes to youth ministry, and I'm competitive and I don't apologize for this, I was listening to a country patriotic song, and there's a line that I love in it. It goes, we're as good as the best and better than the rest. And that's what I want for our youth ministry. Is that okay? Doesn't mean we're better than anybody else, but I want to be as good as the best. Is that okay with you? Look at me, teens. I want you all to look at me, everybody. Look at me. I want you to be free to invite your friends, and I want you to make this youth group what you know it believes needs to be. We need your input. How can we make it better? How can we improve it? Because we want this to be a gathering point where kids are going to come galore, and they're going to meet new friends, but they're always going to meet Jesus. What do I always say? Every person I know is just one friend away from Jesus, one friend away from the church. Are you hearing me? Are you looking at me, teens? You're not looking down. If you're looking down, you're not looking at me. I'm for you, and I'm thankful for you. So many good things happening, and we're going to build on that. We're going to build on that. I have a dream, for example, of the second worship being the real family go-to service, and all of our teens, like today, are in here and bringing their friends, and we just fill this place and honor God and all of that. And another thing we're going to do, we're in the throes of planning now. We're going to peel off. We're going to create a preschool ministry of 5th and 6th grade. Because how many of you know that's an animal of its own now? We're gonna have a specific ministry. It's not going to be children. Cindy's going to focus on grades 1 through 4, and of course Gail before that. Cindy, that's where her sweet spot is. But we're also going to build that, and we're going to build that ministry. So it's going to be like I said, as good as the best. And then high school, we're going to do some combining on all of that. So that's all to come. And here's something that I want you all to know. A real takeaway from Jordan that I've picked up is, and I was pondering this and praying about the change and praying about my attitude towards Jordan since she's leaving when I was in the shower. And just kidding about that. But I felt like the Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, you know how Jordan has just poured her life into a lot of teens, and especially she's connected with so many girls. He said, I want you to plan on this moving forward. I want you to have, in youth ministry, not middle school or high school, in that division, I want you to have a strong male influence, and I want you to have a strong female influence. So we're exploring, we're trying to go that direction, because I believe that was the Holy Spirit inspiration. We need both. We need both in this culture and time. So we're going to move in that direction. And again, what I'm saying about the future is no denigration on the present and the past. I'm so thankful for it all. But I believe God has a way for us to go. And then on top of that, this may be new to you. It's not new to us. But we've had the makings of a family life team. And that's basically all things children, probably more elementary. No, it's all things children through high school, pretty much. And we've kind of done it. We've gotten together for some events, but we want to have a system. I mean, Gail does such a great job, but and then Cindy picks up on that, and then we want our middle school, I mean, our preteen to pick up on that, and then we want our youth. You understand? We're going to have a system, so we're gonna upgrade that. Again, we're gonna be as good as the best, and Pastor Sheldon's gonna step into that role. He works full-time. He's very part-time at the church mentally. He's gonna stay in the part-time role like that, but he's gonna be at the pastoral point of that administrating, and we're gonna plan and pray and work together and strategize and just have a plan. So I'm excited about this. I'm excited. I have sorrow over people coming and going, but I have greater excitement about what can be. So thank you, Sheldon, for being willing to step into that role, and I'm excited to see how it work and unfold. Are you doing okay out there? I told you a lot's coming. Care team. That's just something in the past but the present. I just got to say this, that Rich Day started it. My friend, his wife usually sits over here. He died in 2011, and you got to know Rich to appreciate monotone voice. When he was dying of cancer, he said, Pastor, I'm going to die on your birthday so you'll never forget me. You know what he did? He died on my birthday, August 30th, 2011. And we are building now on what he and Rich Day and what Dan Bishop did. They were trailblazers. We're building on the foundation they laid, and we're doing our best to care for and pastor precious people like you and others. A pastor is always available, and we are privileged to be called pastor. And teens, I want to have your attention again. Look at me. And parents, family, everybody look at me a moment. I know you're texting me, but just wait. I can't get it right now. I'll get it later, okay? But look at me. I would appreciate it. You can't give me and our pastors a better honor than calling them Pastor Sheldon or Pastor Nathan or Nate, whatever. And it's not because we have an ego. It's a privilege to be called that. And parents, I think it's really good to teach your children and grands respect for authority. Does anybody still believe that? So that's not an empty title. That's a good title to have. And I just want to exhort you there a little bit. But I want to tell you, here at Wooster Naz, a pastor is always, an on-call pastor is always available. We've had to call on that this week, and we're privileged again to be called pastor. Care looks differently in this season beyond the virus and all that, but we're trying to do better than ever now. You've all been holding your breath. I'll finish with pastor's retirement plans, because I've heard so many rumors falling around. Like, I've already retired. I've been retired for a year. Really? I've heard that in the community. Some of you said it. That's wishful thinking. Sorry. Well, I'm not retired yet. And honestly, I'm not really about to. I'm 68, and I'm planning for sure to go, God willing, full time until the age of 73, which will be August of 2028. Somebody on the way out is greeting people, said, I'm so glad you're staying to 2038. I go, you better listen again, buddy. And we'll see what develops over that staff board, if I have any kind of role in a healthy church, but whatever. But I want to tell you about the pastoral transition and perpetuation. Some of you, you shake and quake because you've been through some messy church transitions. And it's hard, because I'm not the founding pastor, but I've been here for so many years. And I have an unusual tool bag of gifts. I know that. But I've initiated this process and journey. I tell you that I have, right, Colin? You're on the board. You know, I brought it up. And I said, we got to move forward. So we're on the very front end of an open process to see what the Lord's doing. But with the attention and the assistance of our wonderful pastor leader, Wendell Brown, our district superintendent, he's going to give us guidance through this process. But I want to remind you this. This is why we do annual elections, even though many of your members don't vote. You have voted a church board to represent you. That doesn't mean they're wind checkers. What do you want me to vote? You say, I have confidence in you that you're going to lead us through this process. You're going to represent us very well. So we let them do their work, and they're doing it. They're going to let them do what they were elected to do. and this is one of their responsibilities. But there's a process to it. They're not going to do an end run. They're not going to be secretive and do things behind your back. And I just want to tell you what the typical process is. It's different than Nazarene churches because there aren't a lot of larger churches like ours. There's some larger, but we're probably in the 1% or less of Nazarene churches globally. But here's the process, and we'll print this for you later, but I just want to hit it real quickly. So the DS meets with the church board and begin a process. They begin to pray and dialogue and develop a profile and study the records of possible nominees. And they've already begun to do that in a very casual way. They're talking. They've met, I think, at least twice with the district superintendent. But they're not rushing things. I welcome that. Secondly, the DS and church board will at some point select the nominee and invite them for an interview, and they'll come and interview. And after that, they'll meet the DS and the church board in an executive session to evaluate the candidate's interview. A ballot will be taken after that to determine a candidate should be nominated to the congregation. And if they are, you'll have a chance to vote, and it requires a 2/3 majority vote. I wouldn't come for a 2/3 majority vote, but that's what's required. It'd have to be higher than that. Four, the meeting to vote on a pastor for the church must be announced at least 2 Sundays before the actual vote. Five, before the vote, the congregation will have the opportunity to meet and greet a new candidate if they're without, within, whatever it may be. They'll have a chance to meet and greet, and maybe they might even speak here if they haven't spoken before. Six, in the church meeting, listen, all official members, that's a lot of you who have never voted, 15 years of age and older, will be entitled to vote. There must be a 2/3 majority, again, of a positive vote, and there will be no absentee ballots, and you will not have to show your driver's license. Seven, when a call is extended to a pastoral candidate, they will be given 15 days from the date of the vote to respond. So that's how the process works when you are brought a candidate, is nominated to you. Nod your head if that's making a bit of sense. I just want to be open, I want you to know. So as you can clearly see, and I plead with you to see this, it's not my decision on who your next pastor is going to be. You will decide by your vote. You, we, the people. I guess by then I might be able to vote because I'm we the people. And I'll say again, we don't know. The next lead pastor may come from within or without. The church board has already started dialogue with some of our staff just to find out where they are in their development process, and that's already happening. So in the meantime, would you be life speakers into our staff? Would you call out the gifts and things you see in them? Would you encourage them? You never know what's going to happen in these next years. So in these next few years, while I'm at the point, here's what I want to assure you. I'll keep pouring myself into the younger staff, and that includes everybody. And let the cream rise to the top, so to speak, because we never know what years and experience and maturity will do. And it will be an affirmation, too. We'll be moving towards an executive team model that's still pastor-led, directed. I'll be at that point, but some of our ordained pastors will work even more closely together, meeting more weekly, to really be over the vision and direction of Wooster Naz. That's something we're moving into this year. I've just got to say, as an example of what I'm doing, so you believe that I'm not done. I'm not dead. I'm not done. I still have a passion. I'm not because I felt like it, but I'm involved in a preaching collaborative that's a year. It started last January, a trip to Atlanta. I've talked to you about it. But I'm responsible for a pastor's cohort. There's 6 pastors. 1 dropped out. There's 5 of us now. We meet twice a month for 90-minute Zooms, and I'm not teaching them, I'm facilitating and I'm learning with them, and we're being trained, equipped, and immobilized to be better, more effective evangelistic preachers. And I got to tell you, I'm being challenged and learning, and it's better than any previous training I've ever had in my life. And my goal is to turn around and take our ordained staff through the very same thing, because I'm thinking, man, I wish I would have had this when I was in my 20s or 30s. So I'm just going to keep pouring out. Are you doing okay out there? I need your prayer. We need your prayer. We need your support. We need your encouragement. Finally, 1 Corinthians 12:27 says, all of you together are Christ's bodies. The key word is together, all of you, together. Each one of you is a part, not the whole. All of us are a vital part of it. We're to be a gathering of Jesus, a community of God's grace and truth. And our prayer is, come unity. Holy Spirit, come. Bring unity. May God bind our hearts together by His and in His great love. I think of that song, I Can Only Imagine. When I think of Wooster, Naz, and beyond, I think we can only imagine what it would look like if all the followers of Jesus would embrace this that I just read. What an impact it immediately would have in our community, in our world. I mean, there'd be homes where husbands and wives love each other like Christ loved the church, be sacrificial and serving, and teens and young adults would abandon the lie of our culture that sexual purity is optional and outdated and irrelevant. We'll treat everyone we meet and come in contact with as people for whom Jesus died, and we'll begin to manage God's resources as if everything really does come from Him and belongs to Him. Can you imagine a world like that? I believe Wooster Naz is some of that, but we can become even more of this kind of gathering of Jesus. And I still have a full tank of passion and a burning desire to see lost people get found and experience the living, transformed life that only Jesus can make possible. I've been seeing again in our own family beyond that Jesus still changes lives. Jesus is still changing lives, and He always will. And the model that we adopt at Wooster Naz is relationships matter. Everything rises and falls on relationship. We keep listening and asking questions and listening some more genuinely, and we gain understanding and wisdom as we pour into other people's lives. Sometime after a vision, we wrote this statement. It'll be on the screen. My Wooster Naz, some of what I repeated, but I'll read again. At Wooster Naz, we are passionate about loving God, loving people, living transformed. That's our vision frame. We believe that everything rises and falls on relationship. Our circle of influence expands in genuine relational ways because any person is one friend away from knowing and loving Jesus. Teens, that's true there, I said. Our laser focus is on gathering, linking, and thriving through Naz worship and Naz groups and serve teams and our grow track. Everyone who connects with Wooster Naz will be exposed to love and hope and new life. We believe you belong at Wooster Naz with all of our hearts. One of my favorite pastoral paraphrases, this is not a translation, it's a paraphrase that I often read, and I've read it before, but I want to read it with passion again today. I think I still have a little fuel in my tank, but I'm with a quarter of a tank here. Since I know the shepherd, I do not need to fear anything. Is that a good word for these days? I do not fear poverty, for I shall not want. I do not fear loneliness, because He is right here with me. I do not fear making mistakes, for He guides me in paths of righteousness. I do not fear failure, fatigue, distress, depression, for He restores my soul. I do not fear the future, for goodness and mercy are following me all the days of my life. I do not even fear death, for I will live in God's house forever. God is beneath me in green pastures. He is beside me in still waters. He is with me in the valleys. He is around me in the presence of my enemies. He is upon me, anointing my head with oil. He is before me, leading me in the right path. He is behind me with goodness and mercy. He is far beyond me in heaven, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. What more could I want? Amen. Let's take the journey from here to heaven together. Let's take our kids and grands with us. Let's use our influence for God's glory. We're better together. We're so much better together. We need each other. Others need us. We need them. Let's determine to take many more with us to heaven. May there be no one left behind. No one left behind. I started with, and I'll end with, another old hymn, a classic that I love that we've sung from time to time. We probably need to dig it out of the mothballs. A mighty fortress is our God. Could I just end with these lyrics? Listen, hey, you could take this stuff for your business, for your home, for your family, for God's church. Listen, this is a message of hope. Still relevant. Martin Luther wrote it, I think, in the 1500s or whatever. A mighty fortress is our God. A bulwark, I like that, never failing. Our helper, He, amid the flood of mortal ills prevailing. How many of you know there's a lot of mortal ills prevailing? For still, our ancient foe, that Satan, doth seek to work us woe. His craft, don't underestimate, His craft and power are great, and He's armed with cruel hate. On earth is not His equal. In other words, we're no match, but God is. Did we in our own strength confide, our striving would be losing. Self-help doesn't work. In other words, we're not the right man, Jesus on our side, the man of God's own choosing. Doth ask who that may be, resoundingly, Christ Jesus, it is He. Lord Sabaoth, His name, from age to age the same. And He will win the battle. And though this world, here's where we are, And though this world with devils filled should threaten to undo us, we will not fear, for God hath willed his truth to triumph through us. The prince of darkness grim, we tremble not for him. His rage we can endure, for lo, his doom is sure. One little word shall fell him. Would you stand with me, please, as we sing in a moment? Here's the last one. That word, stand if you can. That word above all earthly powers, no thanks to them, abideth. The spirit and the gifts are ours through him who with us sideth. Let goods and kindreds go, this mortal life also. The body they may kill, but God's truth abideth still. His kingdom is forever. Can I get any amens out there? Come on, let's just express our appreciation to God's faithfulness and goodness in our life.